When it comes to FPS games, your HUD can provide a ton of important information, like telling you how much health you have or finding your next objective. But how valuable is that information? Do you really need anything else? Can you beat Borderlands 2 with only the minimap? The rules for this run are simple. I can only see the minimap. And to make that happen, I cut a minimap-shaped hole in the box of my latest monster shipment and taped it to my screen. My webcam will also be aimed at the screen as proof that I cannot see anything but my minimap in Twitch chat. Also, you should go follow me over there and hang out with us while we do challenge runs. Anyway, you guys will be able to see everything, don't worry. The video won't look like this. Suffering through that is my job. This run will be a bit different from my other runs because we're actually going to be doing this in normal mode as opposed to OP10. I figured the XP farming and side missions I would need to do to level up might add a little bit more pizzazz to this type of run. As for the character we picked, Gage was an obvious choice with her bouncing bullets and death trap and whatnot, so we started our run by following our seeing eye robot home and watching him get his eye ripped out. Oh, great, now we're both blind! Before we took on Knuckle Dragger, I had to get some experience and catch my bearings. So after finding the fast travel station, I held up on the menu to travel to the Giraffe DLC. If you don't know why we call it that... Mordecai can kill some of the level 30 doll guys here, and that gives us a ton of experience. You could keep repeating this process as long as you save quit before the cutscene starts, so I decided to rack up some early XP here. So while we wait for Mordecai to level us up, I'm gonna tell you about today's sponsor, Instant Gaming. Instant Gaming has been my go-to place when I'm looking for game deals. Game prices nowadays can be pretty crazy, and we all want to save money when we can. Even you might be waiting for a game to go on sale right now. And if that's the case, odds are that game is rotting away in your wishlist, and by the time it goes on sale, you could have already moved on or forgotten about it. And that's where Instant Gaming comes in. They have deals on a ton of games, and odds are there's a deal that you will like over there. My favorite part about Instant Gaming is that it's super fast and easy to get your activation codes after your account is verified. I've tested it myself, and it could take less than a minute to get your hands on a new game, as opposed to the indefinite amount of time you could be sitting, waiting, hoping, and praying a game goes on sale. Console homies can save money too, because they have deals for PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and even Nintendo Switch. So stop waiting. Make your gaming instant. How about this? Think of a game you've been wanting to play and use my link in the description to just see what kind of deal they have on it. If you like what you see and end up making a purchase, just know that on top of saving yourself money, you are also supporting the channel. Anyway, let's see how the XP farm is going. What? No, who let the cutscene play? Anyway, that farm is busted, so plan B. I found the fast travel again and held down this time all the way to the bottom to go to Digistruck Peak and open a door, which went surprisingly well. Since I have to edit this video and rewatch all the footage, I can see that we made it to level 4, but I had no idea what level I was at the time. We made it back to Claptrap and started following the silly sounds of his voice until the scary red dots showed up. After getting angry at a small cliff, my overleveled melee power took out the first batch of bully mongs. Knuckle Dragger showed up after that, and I absolutely trickshotted his little brother out of the sky. We killed Knuckle Dragger after that and started looking for Claptrap's eye. Luckily, the minimap gives an objective marker for most things that we need to pick up, so we had an idea of where to look. Items also make a distinct noise when their item card pops up, indicating you're looking at it. Here's an example of that noise. So we combed our surroundings and listened for that sound until we found Velma's glasses and got a reward. I've played this game enough times to know that this chest always gives us a Jacob shotgun. So I snagged that because more pellets equals more chances to hit. I did not realize what I was getting myself into, so I shotgunned a monster to get me through this run. And honestly, I think that was kind of OP because I was clearing out Lyresburg way too easy. I was hitting more shots than I anticipated and developed a few strategies along the way. For example, I found the best way to line up melee attacks is lining up the inner angle of my yellow marker with the bottom corner of the bad guy's red dot. The minimap can tell me what cardinal direction I'm looking in, but it cannot tell me if I'm looking too far up or too far down. So to combat this issue, I would look all the way down and then estimate where the enemy would be, and I felt pretty cool doing this, but rewatching the footage makes me feel a lot less cool because it was not working as good as I thought. I took the Bullymon clearing mission for a little bit more XP and ended up taking the first death of the run. The second, third, and fourth ones too. We also took the Echo collecting mission here, but that didn't go too well. I'll point out the transparency of the minimap now, since I'll probably get comments about it. Parts of the map where there is no terrain are a bit transparent, and I can sometimes get hints to my surroundings. But with a 120 FOV, even if you see the thing you're trying to interact with, it's not exactly free. I see the bullet holes, okay. Oh, I think I got it. I didn't. Where the fuck is this thing?
I know.
I'm about to skip this mission. I don't know if it's worth it.
Yeah, so the moral of the story is that even though I can see through parts of the map, it never really came in handy because learning lineups with the actual map proved far more consistent. Anyway, 5 minutes after I leveled up, I finally unlocked my action skill. So let's bring out Death Trap. Oh no, I didn't pick Gage. I picked Salvador. Anyway, we made our way towards Boom Boom. I wanted to wipe out the bandits here with a skyrocket, but I only managed to kill one psycho with it, so that was pretty cringe. When I got to Boom Boom, someone put a bounty on killing them in under 3 tries. My guess is they didn't have faith in me because I was trying to fight the clouds the whole time, so I don't really blame them. I jumped in and immediately tried to find my way to the back of the arena to lure Boom to a dark alley and take his loot. I was surprised when I got the kill here because I didn't hear any of the noises that usually play when you land a melee hit in Buzzaxe Rampage. But like, Boom is dead, so I'll take it. Boom and Boom both drop a bunch of grenade ammo when killed, so I knew I had plenty of skyrockets I could throw at Boom. Too bad I whiffed like all of them. On my second try, I ran back to Boom's body in hopes that there were more nades lying around. I heard the ammo pickup sound as I ran by, so I knew I had at least one and managed to knock Boom out of his cannon. A few blind swings later, I made 15 bucks and leveled up. You might think that picking skills would be hard if I can't see the skill tree. But honestly, it was super easy because I have Krieg's entire skill tree memorized. Do other character mains memorize the entire skill tree? Or are Krieg mains just built different? I don't know. Anyway, if you open your menu and press 4, it will always take you to your skill tree tab. And you'll always start hovering over your action skill. So all I needed to do was press down once and then enter to spec in to pull the pin, which makes it so we drop a copy of our grenade mod when we die. And if it gets a kill, we get double the amount of XP. Using our new skill, we decided to farm Boom Boom until level 10 by running into the arena, dealing a little bit of damage, and then finishing them off martyr style. Oh look, a bonus package! I wish I seen that. The other 4 points I put in to empty the rage, because a majority of our damage is going to be melee, and the empty mag bonus actually came into play here quite often. We started our climb up to Flint's ship, and things started getting a bit dicey. The minimap is locked to a 2-dimensional plane and will only show you the highest point of the map, so we were practically blind when we had to go under the ship. Yeah, I got really lost down here and started taking cryo damage? How the f*** did I end up in the pre-sequel? What the? We had to keep pushing forward with nothing but muscle memory from playing this game so much. And making it through this part was tough. But now we had to climb up the ship. And that was a nightmare. Staircases, tightropes, walls, bathrooms, holes, skyrockets, enemies that could be below or above me, I don't freaking know. All these things made it just absolutely abysmal to traverse. I again had to go entirely based on memory. Dying would also send me so far back that it was just headache inducing. I got to the point that kept messing me up and decided to just go for a leap of faith over what I thought was a hole. It was actually just a wall. After that, I slowly tiptoed up to the lever to hoist Claptrap up, hit a new use station, and took a sigh of relief. Up next was the Flint fight. Now usually to get him to jump down from his throne, you have to hit him at least once. Insert joke on why that is hard to do. So we died a few times before we had a chance to get close to him. And when we did manage to get close to him, I found out that Flint was easier than the climb up. Never thought that would happen. After that, we made it to Three Horns and ran into a new issue. We needed an interface adapter to get a new car, but the objective marker was a big area circle. I had a general idea of where to go, but this one took a while to find. After that, we got behind the wheel and somehow things got easier. I hit the jump on the first try and even nailed Door Guy pretty good. Finding Reese's Echo was pretty rough too because of the whole big circle objective thing, but the 2500 hours in BL2 saved me there. A little bit of Snake gameplay later, we saved Reese and headed towards the Power Core Psycho.
Oh my god! Wombo combo!
We managed to nab the power core and absolutely slaughtered the 20 bandits to avenge Reese before making it to Sanctuary. At this point, my guns were very underleveled, and finding new gear would be tough considering I can't see any of it, and my numerous deaths would make buying whatever's in the shop a bit hard. But lucky for us, this mission turn-in always gives us a choice between an assault rifle or a shotgun, so I dropped my SMG and went for the shotgun. Glad I remembered it was the second option, because I got a decent bandit shotgun from it. I was hoping for another Jacob's shotgun, but I wasn't disappointed once I heard the bandit gunshot sounds. I had to grab a bunch of stuff here in Sanctuary. I'll try not to go over everything I pick up unless it was tougher than usual, but one thing to note here was I spent my iridium on what I hoped was grenade SDUs. Fun fact, all the upgrades here are alphabetized except for the bank and backpack upgrades, so this was a rare case where extremely obscure Borderlands knowledge actually came in handy. Anyway, Prospering Canyon was our next destination, and I made my way there after fast traveling back to the draft DLC and Claptrap's place by accident. Frostburn was honestly kind of rough. First off, I'm not used to the map not being already filled out because this is a fresh character, and the terrain was far from flat here. I didn't mind dying often because that just meant pull the pin XP, but the fire damage on fire nomads was proving to be ineffective. Once I crawled out of that mess, I had the spike pit skip. Now, I have never failed this jump, but this time around, I wouldn't be able to see my usual lineup. I had a lot in the line, so I just had to go with my gut. Yeah, I can't see shit over here. Alright, hold up. I'm gonna John for a bit, okay? I still think my success rate is 100%. Screw you guys if you think otherwise. My player icon is way too friggin' big to see anything. Not to mention this objective record screwed up my lineup. I'm not Craig, you're Craig. Anyway, we got the skip eventually, and honestly, I don't think it could get much worse than Oh, I forgot about Lilith. Never mind. The bright side to this challenge is that I don't have to see Lilith, but the downside is that I can still hear the one-liner.
Oh, Lilith, why?
Even though Lilith loves to torment me, she did manage to give us our first class mod. It happened to be the best one we could have gotten for this run, which was a blister com with a +6 grenade count. I didn't know this until editing though, so it probably didn't matter that much. Up next, we had to save Roland, and in order to do that, we are going to need a car upgrade. And honestly, destroying the cars proved harder than I anticipated. Half the time, I was just trying to figure out if the red dot was a buzzard or a car. I bet you guys can't tell the difference. My first plan was trying to tail the technicals while aiming up and down and hoping that enough bullets would hit. That didn't work. I then tried to hold all the way down because I knew the cars couldn't look too far down. That didn't work. And we also tried the good old pull the pin kill. And that didn't work. What was the game-winning strategy, you might ask? Well, I got one word for you. Explosions! With the rocket launcher runner and the looking as far down as possible strat, we were able to more consistently take out bandit technicals, and we eventually got enough parts to sneak into the bloodshot dam. Bad Ma was up next, and let me tell you, I died so many times trying to fight this guy. Death after death just kept piling on, and there wasn't anything I could do about it. I mean, I guess I could have tried to survive the fight, but then how would I get the double XP from pull the pin? You guys think I'm gonna farm up to level 16 and not take the twice as fast option? Come on now. Alright, real talk. We farmed Badma up to level 16 so we could get the most important skill of the run. Light the fuse. Now if we end up falling into Fight for Your Life, we will have an extremely useful tool for revives. No more lack of movement, and no more estimating how high I'm aiming because the splash damage means I could just get close and throw him at the ground. And if I'm feeling extra confident, I could just hold E to go full minesweeper mode and murder everything around me. Doing this made the Bloodshot Stronghold relatively easy, right up until the toilet room, where my archenemy, Verticality, found us yet again. It was back to being an absolute guessing game. And boy, am I glad that I took the time to get Light the Fuse here, because even with it, closing the distance between me and these crazed marauders was harder than normal. Anyway, Mad Mike eventually showed up, and I decided to use my out of sight, out of mind card here, and just ignore him. I hit the next new U station, and planned to run away after I came back, but my skyrocket murked him without me knowing, so I'll be taking that card back, thank you. After finding Roland, I got stuck in this hole and just could not find my way out of it. I ended up having to die to get out, which felt pretty cringe and embarrassing. And after that, we made it outside and I put the stinky on myself. Actually guys, this was 100% on purpose. You could tell because I got a pull the pin kill. Yep, After I paid the toll, I started fighting my way through the bad guys. Nothing too crazy, but I did put the stinky on this loader, so I'm glad we got at least one this run. After fighting through all those loaders, we made it to our next fight. If you're new here, you probably don't know that the Warden can take Roland to the Hyperion Friendship Gulag if you don't kill it fast enough. Yeah, and with our current setup, I estimated that chance was pretty high. I went in for my first attempt and got a few second wins before dying about halfway through his health bar. It honestly felt like a tough fight, and I had no idea how close or not close I was to killing the Warden, so I scrambled to get one more good attempt in before it was gulag time.
Can't tell if I used my Buzz X Rampage or not, and I burned it or not, but...
Okay.
Yeah, the Warden is weird. I feel like its shield gets weaker when the Surveyors decide to start juicing it up or something, because that was pretty baffling. After saving Roland, I replaced my first shotgun with a sniper before realizing that didn't make any sense, and then swapping to a TDR SMG I found and heading back home. At this point in the game, my memory of enemy levels is a bit skewed, so I decided to do the Marcus dummy missions for a little XP boost and to secure a slag pistol for future fights. It's not the best option, but it's the only guaranteed slag weapon I could get realistically. Anyway, I also missed Michael Mamoril right here. I like never see this guy, and this challenge run made sure to keep it that way, but oh well, off to Tundra Express. Burning the Varkids here was kind of annoying because I messed up and lost my free tinderbox, and my skyrocket was just way too strong. I could have used this fire shotgun I found, but alas, I didn't know it was fire. I eventually got stuck on the fire melon and managed to wake up Mordecai, meet Tina, dodge a train, and grab the Badonkadonks. The first one was pretty easy to grab, but for the second one, I needed to do a little bit of parkour to bypass the confusing staircase system. On the way to blow up the train, I gained the title of only person ever to unintentionally die to these giant cartoony proximity mines, so that was pretty cringe. I also had my first fight with a ladder and my second fight with a train. We made it to Wilhelm, and this was probably the toughest fight yet. Every challenge about this run piled on right here. I had no idea what level he was, so I had no idea how much damage I was dealing, or if I was even beating out his shield regeneration. I couldn't see incoming attacks, so I had to use audio cues to kind of guess where to dodge. And to top it off, Wilhelm is pretty hard to melee because he kind of has this spike shield effect when you get too close. I gave it a few attempts before almost calling it quits for the day. But on my last attempt before that, I heard Wilhelm start doing callouts, indicating his health was low. So I gave it one more shot, this time with a newfound strategy I will be calling menu leveling. I found that opening and closing your menu put your crosshair at a consistent eye level, and using that we found our combat loop. We would run around, dodge, and throw pot shots until we heard him or seen him start spawning surveyors. At that point, I would pull out my slag pistol and level my crosshair to hopefully get some slag. I would then run at him with Buzz X Rampage if it was charged, or just my plain self and intentionally get downed. After that, I would instantly detonate my bundle. This would damage Wilhelm, stop his surveyors from giving him too much shield, and give me a second win all at the same time. Once I started hearing his low health callouts again, I threw any skyrockets that I had and finished Wilhelm off. When we got back to Sanctuary, I got rid of my Vault Hunter relic because I knew Lieutenant Davis was going to give me a new relic, and the one we got was probably the most useless thing I could have gotten. Honestly, I didn't know what it was, but I liked it anyway. It was way better than Lilith's gift of literally taking my home and my minimap. Like, bro, what am I supposed to do now? I ended up running towards the cliff to spot next to the door, which was unnecessary because an objective marker did show up. But if you watched my vids before, you know that I'm all about the high road. If you haven't watched before, consider subscribing. It helps the channel a lot, and if you've made it this far into the vid, there's a good chance you'll want to watch more. Anyway, we made it to the fridge and had a surprisingly easy time finding the levers to open the doors. Getting across the Hyperion Bridge went well too. I was a little worried about using the gondola to get across because I wouldn't be able to see it, but the thing is super loud, so I knew exactly when it stopped right in front of me. We made it to Mr. Noodle, and I was pretty scared of what this fight could entail. But then, like, the kill almost looked like it was ripped straight out of a casual playthrough. Like, if you haven't spammed skyrockets at this guy before, have you even really played Borderlands? Anyway, so that was like 3 wins in a row. Overlook, though. That was an L. Things started strong, but quickly took a turn when the toaster showed up. Yeah, I didn't think I was going to be able to kill this thing, at least not fast enough to make it worth my time. My favorite part about this whole section is when I got to watch myself try to repair the beacon while I was in light diffuse because I had no idea I was even down. Yeah, that was just really funny to me for some reason. Anyway, the beacon actually didn't go invincible this time around. I thought it did, but I guess it didn't. I still had to shamefully fast travel away from the evil toaster that was shoving nuclear bombs into my soft spot, so that sucked, but progress is progress. We made it back home and went for our next vital piece of gear, the law. Getting it was easy. I just had to empty a weapon slot, correctly identify a killer, accidentally desecrate a corpse, and bam, double melee damage for the rest of the run. The preserve was our next destination, and finding the place was way harder than it should have been. I got stuck in a cave somewhere, and for the first time in the run, I had to save quit because I just couldn't find a way out. Second try took a while, but I made it to the dreaded preserve. Wounding the loaders here went, just kinda got lucky with light the fuse and the door opened. But I did start feeling a bit underleveled here, so I made sure to kill every tiny dot I seen. Anyway, I pushed through all the mobbing and realized that I still get red dots for stalkers even though they're invisible. Didn't make them any less hard though because they just love running away from me. Also, a very weird thing to do if you're literally called a stalker. Anyway, the ultimate loader showed up and worried me a little bit. The game plan was to slag it and just hope that a Buzz Axe rampage duration was enough. I forgot to mention this during the Wilhelm fight, but enemies do have callouts for when they get an element applied to them. In the case for slag, they say something like unknown substance or unit slagged. So I was able to tell when they turned purple and knew exactly when to strike. So I was gonna do a bit here where I said I murdered all the loot dudes super easy while swinging at nothing because I didn't take doctor's orders, but I got lucky and one of them showed up anyway. I checked for a drop and ended up with quite the surprise. And we got like something, I guess. Don't tell me it was a grenade.
Dude, is that a nasty surprise, dude?
3, 2, 3, 4. That's my shield, that's my grenade mod. Skyrocket's back, okay. After a little bit more mobbing, we made it to Bloodwing. This was going to be our first real fight with a flying enemy, so I wasn't sure how it was going to go. But I've been practicing for this fight the whole run. So let's do this.
Go, dude!
Alright, Bloodwing, you had me in the first half, but you gotta step up your game again. I'm about to hit double digits. After the fight, I made the mistake of trying to upgrade my gear and ended up losing my +6 grenade count class mod for something pretty much useless. But on the bright side, at least we got to high-five our homie Claptrap. Up next was recruiting Brick and his air support. The initiation was pretty much just handled by the Skyrocket, if I'm being honest. Apparently, I wasn't supposed to use this thing indoors, but like how the heck was I supposed to read that? I can only see the minimap. Sarcastic Slab could have survived this time around because he didn't show up as a red dot, but his loud clapping let me find him using echolocation. Get it? Because the minimap comes from the echo come on, please laugh! Fighting the loaders with Brick was pretty simple. I was mostly slagging bad guys while he fisted them. I'm pretty sure every single mortar strike killed me here, so that was rough, but hey, Brick is on the squad now and I can finally get rid of my level 1 shield. What the fuck is Michael doing here again? Whatever. Anyway, Roland will always give you a rocket launcher or a roid shield for turning in this quest, so not only do we have a usable shield now, we also get a melee boost when it's broken. Hopefully I don't have to explain why that's useful. Up next was Opportunity, and oh boy, I had to have jammed my shin on every crate, statue, bush, and railing in this map. It took me 10 minutes to find the jack double as per the usual 10 seconds. Killing him felt about the same, but good golly, finding the info kiosks was horrid. I could get close, but actually finding the little buttons was harder than most objectives. I also had to find it while loaders and toasters were bombarding me with everything they had. It took a bit, but I managed to get them all, but that wasn't the biggest issue. I still had to upload the voice data, and to do that, you had to find this little cave, find the right door to get into, and place the watch. I think you guys know where this is going. The minimap only shows the top layer of the map, so this was just complete guesswork on top of tripping over every step along the way. I was going at this for a while, and I was getting very frustrated. But then, my salvation arrived. I've never been so excited to hear about a hot loader in my area, because I knew that this loader always spawns in the room I needed to get to, so I found my way in and took a big sigh of relief. That breather would come in handy, because up next was the climb up to Bunker. Things started out really rough here. I absolutely butchered the ravine jump, I got pranked by Claptrap, and then I just got absolutely decimated by the loaders. I was positive that I was super underleveled at this point, and forcing through this would have been way too hard. So I had to do what I was regretting, and decided to farm some XP. I was hoping that farming the mutated Varkids would be some quick XP, but that proved very inconsistent and I had to find this door valve every time. So regrettably, we had to do the entire Clan Wars quest line. Instead of just walking you guys through the missions, let's just count how many times we needed to interact with a small object.
Nice. Clarifying.
Ugh. 42 painful interactions, not including fast travels and car spawns. And what do I get as my reward? I get to do this for the next hour. I was hoping Mick was at least level 22, but he was only level 20, and the experience falloff was rough. So this last jump from 24 to 25 was a majority of that hour. How many Maggies did I miss? I have no idea. I couldn't see. And rewatching an hour of footage to give you guys one number seems like a silly thing to do. Hey, whoa, editor, don't show him that. Get that out of here. Anyway, after accidentally going to the Hammerlock DLC, we made it back to Thousand Cuts and tried climbing the mountain again. Things felt a lot better this time around. The toaster only took a few tries, the baby turrets were a pushover, and the big toaster got cheesed the good old-fashioned way. And all that was left was Face McShooty.
This is gonna be so cringe if I'm way off.
Alright, so, the bunker. Screw the turrets, those guys were whatever. The bunker was genuinely scary. It flies out of melee range, and unless I'm throwing buzz axes, I have no indication if my shots are actually hitting it. It is also classified as an armored enemy, so the fire resistance made me think skyrockets were not gonna help that much. My game plan was to wait for the bunker to do what I call the flex pose, which is the one where he's just stationary floating in the air. When I noticed the bunker stopped moving, I would try to slag it before entering buzz axe rampage and throwing axes until I hear the axe hit marker and just holding that angle. There were a few spots where I could melee hit it from the bottom, but I didn't know how great that was. This is Can You Beat Borderlands 2 with only the minimap, not Can You Beat Borderlands 2 with only health bars. I found a spot down here where I heard the melee hit marker sound, but I guess I was just hitting a dead turret hurtbox or something. It's super complicated, this game's made of spaghetti. I shouldn't have known this, but someone in chat gave me a hint, which they weren't supposed to do, so I had three options. Use the hint and stop doing this strat because it wasn't actually dealing any damage, which felt cringe. Keep using the strat, consciously throwing to replicate what I would have done without the hint, which felt cringe. Or spec in to silence the voices and just tell myself that throwing axes was safer because I didn't want to hit myself, which felt less cringe.
No hints!
Ugh. I'm about to start strangling people who give me hints. You guys are getting cooked the fuck up in the video. It's a joke. I know this was not intentional, and I'm just probably being like an asshole over arbitrary challenge, arbitrary rules. Here's the lore, okay? I spec'd in to silence the voices, so I did not feel comfortable meleeing the bunker in the way that I was. That way, I can lie to myself instead of having to lie to myself through throwing. There's the lore.
Axo Deagle, what are we literally talking about?
My f***ing god. Oh my god. No hints.
No hits!
Someone sacrificed Exodeagle! Oh my f***ing god!
We love you, Exodeagle. Don't forget that.
If anything else, Exodeagle, that's going in the video, and you get to hear me scream your name in the video.
Anyway, this fight was tough, but I knew it was possible, because the bunker started bringing out its big slag cannon, which meant it was at 50% health, which meant I was doing damage. But this also meant that standing still trying to throw axes wasn't gonna work anymore. So preying on the good old skyrocket was the way to go. Instead of going into Buzzaxe Rampage, I would try to slag the bunker and throw any skyrockets I had. If I was out, I would patrol the outer ring for Brick's air support drops, and then just hide up here until the bunker was in a good spot. It also probably would have helped if I didn't accidentally sell my class mod and lose my burn damage, but oh well, who needs a class mod anyway? My stubbornness was really put to the test here. 1 hour in, I had this heartbreaking death. Another hour later, history repeated itself. And after 3 hours and one extremely close clutch moment, the bunker entered its deathbed spot.
Jump, jump. Land right on him. Oh! Oh! Okay, here we go. Let's play this right.
Dude.
After finding the bitch that the bunker dropped, I descended down to Angel Core, where the only challenge was pressing this button every time I died and trying not to cringe at Lilith. I couldn't really tell where the injectors were, but some trial and error with my skyrockets was all I needed to fix that issue. Some other stuff happened that I couldn't really see. I think Roland's fine, but I know one thing's for sure. Lilith stole my friggin' minimap again. Anyway, after making it out of Marcus's closet, we got the Order Shield to combo with our Law Pistol and made it to the Iridium Blight. We took a few side missions here because I thought they would be easy. Yeah, I was totally wrong. I tried to visit Jack's grandma, and it took me 10 minutes just to find the door to get in. The other mission was actually pretty easy. Jack just gave me a bunch of iridium to jump off a cliff, but I've been doing that the whole run, so that was pretty easy. After those two side missions, we made it to Sawtooth Cauldron. Yeah, do I really have to tell you guys why this place sucked? Oh, I do? Okay, well, cave. I've been over it before, so this time I'm just gonna show you what I went through. Nope, this is being generous. You're gonna get exactly what I went through. This whole cave system was full of stairs, railings, boxes, bad guys, and lava pits, and it was completely untraversable because the map was displaying the top of the buzzard nest instead of the cave where I needed to be. My only hope was to go around to the west entrance of the cave where I knew the surroundings a bit better and try to take out the ambush commanders there. For once in my life, I was actually glad to constantly respawn at the Death Cubby. After I got there, I pretty much roleplayed like I was playing one of those games where the objective is just to completely dismember yourself to make the score go up. You would have thought I had a Mountain Dew addiction with the amount of double XP I was getting down there. Alright, so guys, how was that? Was that fun? Did you guys have a good time watching that? That was like 30 seconds of only being able to see the minimap. Okay, now try doing 22 hours. Okay, hopefully that gave you guys a little taste of what this was like. Borderlands players hate Sawtooth Cauldron anyway, so I bet this was therapeutic for some of you. After I killed the ambush commanders, I got lazy and save quit to go to Boombringer to blow it up. The game said I looked at the explosion, which was a fucking lie. I'm looking at cardboard, so that got me a little angry. So I took out my anger on Mortar and took the elevator up to the buzzard's nest. It was very important that I sent the elevator down before leaving it, because finding that other button without an objective marker would have been horrendous. I died many times up here trying to kill the buzzards. Throwing skyrockets and getting lucky with light diffuse was pretty much my only hope with these guys because I had no way to tell how elevated they were. I lost track of how many times I had to take the elevator up trying to kill these things, and the last one survived my stormtrooper aim for quite a while before I managed to take it down. Oh, I forgot to mention that we grabbed $9 off of Kai's body while we were here. It will come in handy later, I promise. We made it to the boneyard and leveled up. I didn't realize we leveled up, so get used to the skill point blinking now. I'm still surprised how much easier driving was compared to walking. Like, this shot through this narrow gap made my jaw drop while I was watching through the footage. I'm also surprised that I didn't perma-slag myself a single time here. I have trouble doing that when I can see. The tunnel pumping station, aka the Sergeant Loader gang hideout, was another one of those places where the minimap just told me nothing. I was stuck in this little corner I didn't even know existed for such a long time, but we eventually hit all the levers, rammed the pipe, and somehow climbed the ladder sideways to make it to the Badlands. This part was concerning. Killing Saturn was just off the table, but I still had my out of sight, out of mind card that I stole back from Mad Mike. Running past Saturn was still pretty tough. Like, I had to like scramble to get on this elevator fast enough, and then I had to deal with loaders, giant evil toasters, frickin' stairs. A few resets in, my muscle memory guided me all the way to the top floor before the exploders got to me again. I wasn't mad at all though. I knew how to get to where I needed to be, and it was just a matter of staying alive.
Focus. Okay. Come on. Come on, no.
Oh, that fucking constructor stole my kill.
Oh, no shot. Hold on. Okay. Run, 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 run. Okay, I'm not in. I don't think I'm in. And then I go to the right.
Holy sh. Okay, guys. I genuinely think that was going to be the last hard part.
It was time for the final stride, and to prepare, we upgraded that useless sniper relic we got earlier with a damage resistance relic that Tannis gave us, and we gave that $9 back to Marcus to get the evil smasher.
I know what you're thinking, just trust me on this one, okay?
The claptrap door combat went fine, it actually went pretty fast, but Hero's Pass on the other hand took a bit longer than usual. I didn't think I was going to be able to do the skip, and taking my skyrocket off to do grenade jumps sounded risky, so this time around I fought with Brick and Morty until the path was clear.
If I do this skip, I'm just saying, if I hit this skip... I am pogging so hard right now.
The final battle was upon us, and Jack was gonna put up a fight. Never mind, he just got swept. Like, absolutely rolled and smoked. The real final boss was a bit harder. The lava got me a few times because I just couldn't see it when it was rising. But Gas Mask just listened to Lilith's warning. Oh, shut the fuck up. No, shut the fuck up. We hate Lilith around here. The chrysalis were decent revive fodder here, but I had to trust my ears because their red dots would just disappear often. But as long as I could find one, I could usually get a second win. The warrior took my life 6 times before I found a working strategy, and this is how I did it. I positioned myself where the rising lava, chrysalis projectiles, and warrior's fire breath couldn't get to me, and I pulled out the evil smasher. Guys, stop laughing at me. I'm being serious, guys. Just listen. Anyway, for the people who haven't used this since 2013, back before the nerf, this gun has a 7% chance to proc a bunch of stat boosts every time you reload. So while I was waiting for the warrior to show up in my line of sight, or route of sight, I don't know, someone tell me a better map joke, please. Anyway, while I was waiting, I would just keep spamming the reload until I heard the activation sound. If it did activate, I would dump my mag into him when he got there, and if it didn't, I would try for slag and throw buzz axes instead. The evil smasher is widely regarded as a terrible weapon nowadays, but I think it's actually pretty good. 7% of the time. I still had no idea how much damage I was doing or if I was even shooting the warrior sometimes, but I had faith in my strategy. And eventually, we noticed something.
He's not moving. He might be in deathbed. I'm gonna give it a second just to make sure. Oh, you know what? Super obscure Borderlands knowledge coming in handy. That chrysalisk is gone. That chrysalisk is gone because warrior is in fact in deathbed phase. Come on, let me smash some evil.
Let me smash some evil, I wanna end this run. Let me smash that evil, I'm gonna drink that fun. Let me smash that evil, the evil needs to be smashed. Let me smash that evil needs to be smashed. Everybody with me now. Let me smash that evil needs to be smashed. Let me smash that evil needs to be smashed. Don't let that 7% get you down, cause you know when it procs it will flip your frown. Come on, evil smasher, I hardly know her.
I ain't the sharpest smasher in the shed, but 7% of the time, that evil do be dead. Okay.
Yeah,
let me smash that evil. That evil needs to be smashed. Let me smash. Fuck.
Bozo.
No, I was the evil all along.
Oh, first try. You want to know why it was first try? Because it knows that we're about to be smashing some evil.
And just like that, now we know. You can beat Borderlands 2 with only the minimap. Bonus content time, woo! So we managed to conquer every challenge that this run threw at us. All except for one, so I decided that it was time to go back and snipe Face McShooty.
This is how we're gonna do it, okay? Everyone think of a number right now, but you pick one or two. Everyone think of the number in their head. Don't say it in chat. Everyone pick one or two. If you picked one, you're gonna give me hints. If you picked two, you're gonna lie to me and pretend you're giving me hints.
Bit more left? I don't know about the left, guys. I think you guys might be fooling me. Yeah, left down? You're too far up? Right there? That moment when everyone picked two? Get out of here. Up. Okay, everyone's saying up is a fucking liar. I've caught you. More left cheeseburger? More? How about that? How's that? Okay. Nomass Jr. First time chatter. No. Okay. I can trust Nomass Jr. They weren't here for the rules.
Oh, Nomass Jr. Let's fucking go, dude. Yes! Holy shit! Oh my god!
Before you go, I just wanted to say thank you so much for making it this far into the video. If you want to support the channel, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. It really helps with the YouTube algorithm, and I love hearing your guys' kind words and ideas for new runs. If you want to support the channel more directly, consider becoming a channel member to get videos a day early, saving yourself some money over at Instant Gaming using my link, or going to gasmaskgang.com to get some... Editor, what is that? No, fix it. There we go. Or going to gasmaskgang.com to get some merch. I'll leave my Discord and Twitch channel where I stream these runs live in the description. And last but not least, shout out to MangoSoda, who made this video's thumbnail art. They do commissions and will also be linked below. But until next time, breathe easy, homies.